59. Tripitaka Tang's path is blocked at Mountain of Flames. Pilgrim Sun baits for the first time the palm leaf fan. Seed natures are basically the same. The sea accepts without end. 10,000 thoughts and cares are folly all. Each form, each kind's in harmony. One day with work and merit complete. Perfected real nature towers on high. Let no thing amiss slip to east or west. Lock on and tighten your hold. Pick and safe keep it in the elixir stove. For smelting until it's red like the sun. Bright and brilliant, all aglow. Astride the dragon you'll come and go. We were telling you about Tripitaka, who obeyed the instruction of the Bodhisattva and took back Pilgrim. Along with 8 rules and Sha Monk, he severed the 2 minds and shackled both ape and horse. United in mind and effort, they pressed on toward the western heaven. We cannot begin to describe how time flies like an arrow, how the seasons pass like the weaver's shuttle. After the torrid summer, the frosty scenery of late autumn again appeared. You see. Thin broken clouds as a west wind turns brisk. Distant cranes cry, woods frosted like brocade. What a scene of timely sadness. Where endless hills stretch endless streams. To north borders the wild geese fly. To south lanes blackbirds return. The wayfarer's road is lonesome. The monk's robe swiftly grows cold. However, as master and disciples, the 4 of them, proceeded, they gradually felt a stifling heat. Reining in his horse, Tripitaka said, "It's now autumn. How is it that the heat is so intense? You may not know of this," said 8 rules. "But there is, on the journey to the west, a Shurya kingdom. It is the place where the sun sets, and that's why its popular name is the Edge of Heaven. During the time of late afternoon each day, the king will send people up to the battlements to beat the drums and blow the bugles, in order to dilute and weaken the sound of the sea boiling. For the sun, you see, is the true fire of Grand Yang, and when it drops into the western sea, it's like flames plunging into water and creating a deafening sizzle. If there were no drums or bugles to lessen the impact, the children in the city would all be killed. With this stifling heat here, this place must be where the sun sets." When the great sage heard this, he could not hold back his laughter, saying, "Idiot, don't talk nonsense. If it's the Shurya kingdom you're thinking of, it's much too early. When you consider the sort of delays the master has had to face night and day, it may take him several lifetimes from youth to old age and back again, and even then he may not get there." "Elder brother," said 8 rules. "If you say that this is not the place where the sun sets, then why is it so hot? There must be something wrong with the climate," said Sha Monk. "So that you have summer weather in autumn." As the 3 of them debated like that, they came upon several buildings by the road, all having red tiles on the roof, red bricks on the wall, red painted doors, and red lacquered wood benches. Everything, in fact, was red. As Tripitaka dismounted, he said, "Wukong, go and ask in that house and see if you can uncover the reason for the heat." Putting away his golden hooped rod, the great sage straightened out his clothes and affected a civil manner as he left the main road to walk up to the house. Just then an old man emerged from the main door, who wore a not quite yellow and not quite red robe of grass cloth. His head had on a not quite blue and not quite black hat of bamboo splint. His hands held a not quite crooked and not quite straight staff of knotted bamboo. His feet trod on a pair of not quite new and not quite old calf-length leather boots. His face was like red bronze. His beard seemed like white chains. 2 aged eyebrows topped his lustrous eyes. 1 grinning mouth revealed some teeth of gold. When he caught sight of Pilgrim, all of a sudden, the old man was somewhat startled. Leaning on his bamboo staff, he shouted, "What sort of a weird creature are you, and where are you from? What are you doing here before my door?" Bowing deeply, Pilgrim said, "Old patron, please don't be afraid of me. I'm no weird creature. This poor monk has been sent by Imperial Commission of the Great Tang in the land of the East to go seek scriptures in the West. There are altogether four of us, master and disciples. We have just arrived in your noble region, and when we feel how hot the weather is, we want very much to know what the reason is for it, and what is the name of the land here. I have come especially to seek your instruction." Greatly relieved, the old man smiled and said, "Elder, please don't be offended. This old man was somewhat dim-sighted just now, and I couldn't quite recognize you."
"Not at all," replied Pilgrim.
Then the old man asked him again, "Where is your master?"
"Over there,"
said Pilgrim. "The one standing on the main road south of us. Please ask him to come. Please ask him to come here," said the old man. Delighted, Pilgrim waved at Tripitaka, who immediately approached with eight rules and Sha Monk, leading the white horse and pawing the luggage. They all bowed to the old man. When the old man saw how distinguished Tripitaka appeared and how strange eight rules and Sha Monk looked, he was both startled and delighted. He had no choice, however, but to invite them inside to be seated before he asked his houseboys to serve tea and to prepare a meal. When Tripitaka heard him, he rose to thank him, saying, "May I ask the Gong Gong why it is that such intense heat returns to the autumn of your noble region?"
"Our humble region," replied the old man,
"is named the Mountain of Flames. There's neither spring nor autumn here. All four seasons are hot."
"Where is this mountain?"
asked Tripitaka.
"Is it on the way to the west?"
"You can't go to the west," replied the old man. "For that mountain, about 60 miles from here, sits squarely on the main road. It's covered with flames for over 800 miles, and all around not even a single blade of grass can grow. If you walk on this mountain, you will turn to liquid, even if you have a bronze skull and an iron body." Paling with horror, Tripitaka dared not ask another question. Just then, a young man passed by the front door, pushing a red cart and calling, "Rice puddings." Pulling off one piece of hair, which he changed into a copper penny, the great sage went out to the young man to buy his puddings. After taking the money, and without dickering over the price, the man at once untied the wrap on his cart and took out a piece of steaming hot rice pudding to hand over to Pilgrim. When it touched the palm of his hands, Pilgrim felt as if he had received a piece of lit charcoal or glowing nail taken from the blacksmith's stove. "Look at him." He switched the pudding from the left hand to the right hand and back again to the left, and all he could say was, "Hot. Hot. Hot. I can't eat this."
"If you're afraid of heat," said the man, chuckling,
"don't come here. It's this hot around this place."
"Look, fella," said Pilgrim,
"you're not quite reasonable. The proverb says, without heat or cold, five grains will not grow. But the heat of this place is intense. Where do you get your flour for the pudding?" The man said,
"If you rice pudding flour desire, immortal iron fan inquire."
"What has a mortal iron fan got to do with it?" asked Pilgrim. The man said, "That immortal iron fan happens to have a palm leaf fan. If he lets you have it, one wave of the fan will extinguish the fire. The second will produce a breeze, and the third will start the rain. Only then can we sow and reap in due seasons, and that is how we produce the five grains. Without the immortal and the fan, not a blade of grass will grow in this region." On hearing this, Pilgrim dashed inside and handed the piece of rice pudding to Tripitaka, saying,
"Relax, master. Don't get anxious before you have to. Eat the pudding first, and I'll tell you something."
Holding the pudding in his hand, the elder said to the old man of the house,
"Gong Gong, please take some pudding. I haven't even served you tea or rice,"
answered the old man. "Would I dare eat your pudding?" Smiling, Pilgrim said,
"Dear sir, you need not bestow on us any tea or rice. But let me ask you instead, where does the immortal iron fan live?"
"Why do you ask?" said the old man.
Pilgrim said, Just now the pudding peddler said that this immortal has in his possession a palm leaf fan. If he lets us have it, one wave of the fan will extinguish the fire, the second will bring on a breeze, and the third will start the rain. Then the people of your region can sow and reap the 5 grains for your livelihood. I would like to find him and ask for the fan to extinguish the mountain of flames. We'll be able to pass then, and you people may also find a more stable existence by being able to plant and harvest according to the seasons. Yes, replied the old man. What the peddler said was correct. But you people don't have any gifts, and I fear that the sage will be unwilling to come here. What sort of gifts does he want? Asked Tripitaka. The old man said. The families of the region will seek an audience with the immortal once every 10 years, and, as first meeting presents, they must offer 4 hogs and 4 sheep, rare flowers and fine fruits in season, chickens, geese, and mellow wine. After cleansing themselves in ritual baths, they will go up in all sincerity to his immortal mountain, to beg him come here to exercise his power. Where is that mountain located? Asked Pilgrim. And what's its name? How many miles away? I'll go ask him for the fan. The mountain, replied the old man, is southwest of here, and it bears the name of Jade Cloud Mountain. In the mountain there is a cave by the name of the Palm Leaf Cave. When the believers from our region go to worship on that mountain, the round trip takes approximately a month, for the distance is slightly over 1,450 miles. That doesn't matter, said Pilgrim with a laugh. I'll be back in no time. Wait a moment, said the old man,